with the Department of State and the U.S. Diplomacy Center. I develop teacher and student programs for the forthcoming museum and visitor center at the U.S. Department of State called the U.S. Diplomacy Center. The U.S. Diplomacy Center will be a museum and educational center devoted to bringing the story of American diplomacy to life for visitors. And I am proud to have my friend and colleague, Kate McNamee, Director of the Office of Teaching and Learning in the Department of Global Education with the District of Columbia Public Schools. Kate, welcome. I am so grateful for our partnership with DCPS, which allows the U.S. Diplomacy Center to share content as we prepare for a national audience. The U.S. Diplomacy Center has also enjoyed working with the DCPS's Embassy Adoption Program. So, Kate, welcome and thanks for being with us today.
Well, thank you for inviting me. We really are grateful for the work that you're doing. Learning about diplomacy is so important for our program in particular, as we have students meeting with diplomats throughout the year. Embassy Adoption Program has been a part of DCPS for 40 years and has 1,500 students paired with different embassies. We really give our students the charge not only to work with diplomats, but really to become diplomats on behalf of our city and our school district as well. And I think it's tools like these that really enable them to do that.
Excellent. And that's why, in fact, we're building this center. And so our program today, I'm going to discuss a little bit about what the museum and visitor center is going to be, and then also show our visitors here today our educational website, Discover Diplomacy. So we're going to switch now to some slides. And you can see in this opening image, in the middle of the image, our sitting Secretary of State, John Kerry, and flanked on either side of him are our past Secretaries of State, Hillary Clinton, Madeleine Albright, Henry Kissinger, James Baker, and Colin Powell, who joined us here earlier this fall for a fantastic groundbreaking ceremony for the Visitor Center. So the Visitor Center will be a part of the Main State Building here in Washington, D.C., just off the 21st Street entrance. It will serve as our new entrance to the 21st Street side, but also house educational exhibitions and programs. So it's located, and if we can switch now to show where we're going to be located. We're going to be located in the heart of Washington, D.C., so as we have all our 8th graders pilgrimage to Washington, D.C., we certainly want to be a stop along the way for folks to come and learn more about diplomacy and the work of our diplomats, because that's, in fact, what most people question. They wonder, who are our diplomats and what kind of work are they doing around the world? And this is what the U.S. Diplomacy Center will aim to answer through interactive exhibits. The center will be of immense interest to educators and students.
We're particularly excited as a district that is starting to invest in the idea of experiential learning. We had a City's Classroom Task Force this summer. We are really excited to be home now to not only the many museums that we have in this area, but now 10 minutes from the White House, from Lincoln, we're going to have the first museum in the country devoted to diplomacy here for our students to explore.
Excellent. And the center will be three halls. The first hall you'll see here on your screen is that big box, square box to your left with the big circle scrolls there. This is where you'll enter into the museum. And this hall is called Discover Diplomacy, and it will help visitors to explore how American diplomacy matters to them today. There will be vivid and multimedia exhibits and artifacts that will put them into the diplomat's shoes so they may learn about how American diplomats carry out U.S. foreign policy around the world and meet the challenges of modern diplomacy. The second hall, which is in the top right corner of your screen there, is Diplomacy in Action. And this hall is dedicated to for visitors to have the opportunity to explore American diplomatic history and how it has shaped our lives today. There's an embassy wall right in the middle of that hall that will allow visitors to be a part of an American ambassador's embassy team as they negotiate and work through thorny international issues through interactives and role-playing. And then lastly, but certainly not very importantly, is our third hall, which you see in the lower right corner, sort of that rectangle shape, is our third hall, advancing diplomacy, which will draw visitors into educational activities, including the Power of Peace Theater, a video teaching about negotiations, and a diplomatic simulation classrooms, study spaces for in-depth exploration of current issues like climate and health, and other exhibits highlighting the relevance of diplomacy in visitors' lives. Our visitors will be thrilled to learn that we have 6,000 objects in our collection that help tell the story of American diplomacy. We have beautiful gifts to secretaries of state. We have objects of symbolic of historic events, like the sculpture made of shrapnel of a destroyed nuclear missile that you see on the bottom left picture in your screen there. Tools of the trade, like a typewriter used by Dean Acheson when he served as Secretary of State from 1949 to 1953, or the Lamson pneumatic tube that shot around the State Department building as its fast messaging system from 1961 to 1975, and you see that right in the middle of your screen. It was sort of the email of its day. It's important to remember that the admission to this museum is free. We want lots of school groups coming. We will plan on hosting teacher programs. We'll be open 7 days a week for our tourists that come to D.C. There will also be a lower level to the museum where we'll have a cafe and a gift shop, so visitors will be able to browse that. So we are very excited to have the center come to Washington, D.C., and to have groups like DCPS's school students come and visit. What do you say, Kate?
Absolutely. DCPS can't wait to bring our students there as well. The topics and the range that are going to be covered by the museum really mesh well, not only with classes like embassy adoption, but also our civics and governments courses that our high school juniors are undertaking. So I see a lot of overlap here with our content, with our curriculum as a district, and we can't wait to get them there.
Yes, and we look forward to that. Well, our hangout today, the focus of the hangout is an educational website called Discover Diplomacy. And although we are building these exhibits today, our outreach programs have begun. We're working with students and teachers already, and we have this wonderful website that we want to show to you today, Discover Diplomacy, which you can find from our State Department website. And we're going to go to that State Department website right now. And under the Youth and Education, the first tab under it is Discover Diplomacy. You'll get you right to the main page there. This landing page unto itself, I feel, is a wonderful teaching tool. You'll see in the middle a slideshow with provocative questions such as, what is diplomacy, for your students to mull over? Is it solving problems, or is it avoiding wars? Followed by, who does diplomacy, where, and what does diplomacy help to resolve? These questions get students, as you think about introducing a unit on diplomacy, thinking about what diplomacy is and where it takes place. In the bottom left, you see a Watch Now Diplomacy Is. This is a 60-second animated video with music in the background that helps to introduce the colors and the icons of the website. But really, unto itself, it's a wonderful teaching opportunity for students to get a sense that diplomacy is the Department of State sending diplomats around the world, working in U.S. missions, consulates, and embassies, promoting American values overseas, and safeguarding American interests as well. I also want to bring your attention to the header and the footer of this page. The header at the top, Diplomacy 101 and Explore. The website is divided into two sections, which we'll take a closer look at in a minute, Diplomacy 101 and Explore. And then at the bottom, you see a diplomatic dictionary, which if you click in, offers a nice menu of terms associated with diplomacy that help the student better understand the world that our diplomats are engaged in. We also have an educator's resource page, which offers more in-depth ideas as to how you can use this website into your classroom. And then, you are a diplomat. So as a student is piqued by the idea of a career in diplomacy, or if they just simply want to become involved, lots of ideas, whether it's taking the Foreign Service exam to become a Foreign Service officer, or becoming involved in an NGO that is focusing on an international issue, or simply studying a language or becoming involved with government. There's some ideas for your students here. Great. So let's go to the top, Diplomacy 101. And you'll see that the website is framed by three things: people, places, and issues. And beyond each of those frames, you see a series of questions here, sort of as is the primer for diplomacy and the State Department and our diplomats. And so, Kate, I know that you work a lot with your embassy adoption program at DCPS, and I've loved using this website with your educators and students, but do you see a question here that you feel works best with that program?
Yeah, I think just as basic as who is a diplomat. This is something that our teachers sometimes struggle with defining for our students. So let's go with who is a diplomat.
Great. So as you click in, you see that the website is designed pretty simply. As you click into that question, you see a one-page statement, if you will, of that term. And as you look closely, you may see certain words underlined in blue. If you hover over that, you will see a definition of what that term is, bilateral, for example. And that's a really important term that we're going to continue to talk a lot about today, our relationship with a particular country. And as you continue to scroll down, you'll see additional links right back to state.gov. And what's wonderful about Discover Diplomacy is that it provides a filter on top of state.gov, which is the State Department's main website. It's full of great information, but it's a really big site. So Discover Diplomacy really helps to filter out for the teachers and the students some really core things that they might be interested in. And at the bottom of each page, you have links back to that. Great. And getting back to the main Diplomacy 101 is as simple as hitting your back button. And Kate, do you see another question that you might find interesting?
Yeah, let's go down the line. Let's do, what is a U.S. embassy?
Perfect. So here, again, going back to that bilateral term, U.S. embassy here, so it's a nice description that we have U.S. embassies all around the world, most of them located in the capital in most countries. We also have consulates and missions, and as you scroll down, you see that the mission and the consulate, you can link back to those questions to learn about what a U.S. mission and consulate is. So wonderful. If we click back, we're now going to go to the Explorer section, and you'll see visually things are a little different here because there's a backdrop of a world map and there's lots of dots on it. But again, you see at the top, we are still filtering things through the people, places, and issue lens. So if we go to people, you see a number of dots that are on the map that highlight some really important diplomats in our diplomatic history. Let's look at Frances Elizabeth Willis. And if you click in, you'll learn a little bit about Miss Willis, who was appointed to be a U.S. ambassador multiple times. In this case, her description of being ambassador to Ceylon, which is present-day Sri Lanka. And what's important about Frances Willis is not only was she the first female ambassador appointed, she was the first female career foreign service officer. So she was a member of the Foreign Service and then appointed as a career foreign service officer to be ambassador. Then we'll go to places. And you see, once again, multiple dots. And on these dots, they represent where our U.S. embassies are around the world. Kate, do you see something you wanna choose?
Yeah, let's go with the U.S. embassy in Beijing.
Yeah, there you go. Perfect. Well, here again, kind of highlighting that bilateral idea, we're looking at the U.S. embassy China. You see some beautiful views of our embassy there and the Jeff Koons sculptures in front. And as you scroll down, you learn about, in the text, you learn about our bilateral relationship with China. Some of the activities that our embassy is doing there is highlighted for you. And then on the right, you see direct connections to their social media platforms, which are current and up-to-date. So if a student is coming to this page and they're interested in China and they want to see what our U.S. embassy is doing there right now, in this moment, they can click into those to find out. And then as you scroll down, you see lots of links to our consulates and all throughout China. You see how many that there are, as well as to the Chinese embassy here in Washington, D.C. Then, I want to bring your attention to this YouTube video link. And something that the Department of State has started to do, which is a wonderful education and teaching tool, is as a U.S. ambassador is appointed and goes to post in any given country, there's a welcome video that is made. Short, only about 3 minutes, but packed with wonderful information about our bilateral relationship with that country. And in this case, Max Baucus, who's our current U.S. ambassador to China, he offers his welcome to the Chinese people before he went on out. And so it's a wonderful, and this will take you right to YouTube, teachers. So, and once you go to YouTube, you'll find out there's many of these videos of U.S. ambassadors that offer a really great window into how an ambassador becomes an ambassador and what kinds of things they do there. And so it's a wonderful teaching tool. As you continue to scroll down, you'll see lots of links back to the State Department and to those parts of the department that deal with China as a region, but also on the issues that are important between our two countries and the issues that Max Baucus, the ambassador there, helps to work with his counterparts. So great. And so it's a great one-stop shop, if you will, for teachers and students if they're in, you know, if they're studying that if they're studying that country. Kate, what do you think?
Yeah, absolutely. I agree completely with the idea of it being a one-stop shop, and it's such a nice tool for our teachers to know that there is one space where they can direct students to dig in deeper to these different issues, to learn about the embassies abroad, to learn about different bilateral issues that might be going on, to use these different informational texts and videos. It really is a great resource.
We totally agree, and especially as students travel to Washington, D.C., they're interested in visiting foreign embassies here in Washington. And this is a great way for them to understand not only do those foreign embassies that are here in D.C., we have the counterpart in their countries of a U.S. embassy, and our diplomats are essentially doing the same thing that their diplomats are doing here in this country. So it's a really nice connection for them. Okay, so finally, we're going to take a look at the issues section of this Explore section of the Discover Diplomacy website. And teachers, as you link into this part of our website, it might take us a moment or two for that page to load. And as most of the site really explores what is diplomacy and who does diplomacy and where, this part of the site really looks at why we do what we do and how diplomacy affects you, the American. How does it affect us? So this splash screen here kind of explores that idea. And if we click out of that, you'll see some headers at the top: securing peace, promoting prosperity, protecting resources, respecting rights, and saving lives. So what we've done here is all the issues that the department works on, we've kind of created these headers so we can more simply organize them. And as you click into one of the headers that you'll see, there's a bit of description underneath of that header for the teacher or student to get a better understanding of what do we mean by promoting prosperity. Since we've talked a lot about bilateral relationships today, I'd like to link into that multilateral organization. And here on the left, you'll see an explanation as to what we mean by multilateral organization. And again, we have a link back to the bureau or the area of the State Department that handles our relationship with multilateral organizations, and a list of many multilateral organizations that we are involved with. We thought we would take a look at the UN because I know the Model UN program is something very popular with high school students. And here, once you hit the UN, you see the colors of the map change, and you see all of the members of the UN are shaded, and you can see the key on the left. And then you also see that green bubble, and once you click it, you will see a brief bio on our U.S. ambassador to the UN, Samantha Power, and of course her office, if you will, is at the UN in New York City. And then you can easily click out of that. The other thing that I would take a look at is under the protecting resources. I know climate And the environment is a really important issue to young people. They're very concerned about what's going on around the world, and climate change and the environment is a popular model UN issue. Kate, I think our group here in DC for our model UN, I think environment is one of their issues, right?
That's correct, yes, for both our fifth and sixth this year.
Excellent. So here we've chosen endangered species. So if you click into that, again on the left, you see a description of what we mean by endangered species. You get a sense of the part of the department that's working on those issues. And then if you look at the countries and how the shadings change based on a convention on international trade in endangered species of wild fauna and flora. I know it's a mouthful, but they call it CITES, and who supports it. So you can kind of get a sense of around the world where other nations are on that issue. And then again, once you go to the bubbles and you click it, you can learn a little bit of an initiative or what are diplomats in that part of the world are doing to, in this case, learn to love lemurs or save the depleting lemur population and the programs that we have in Madagascar to regenerate the population of lemurs. So student, and I want to mention as you scroll down and if you read more and you click that, you're directed right back to the full story of that, and that's basically how this site works. So a student gets a full breadth of the work that we do and where.
Lauren, I want to say that's the thing I really love about this site, and you see it with the maps, and you see it in throughout the site, is that it's really operating as a lens through which students can be viewing this existing information. So it's taking really complex text and informational texts and making it really approachable for students and for our teachers.
Excellent. And that's why we also have that diplomatic dictionary as well. So if there's something that they don't understand, they can click into that dictionary, search a word, and hopefully have their question answered. Okay, so I want to look at one more map before we take some questions. And that would be the refugee map. So under Saving Lives, we have refugee assistance. We've pulled this data in from the UNHCR, or the UN High Commission on Refugees. And again, you can see a description of what we're talking about, what UNHCR is and what a refugee is, because these are really important terms. Students see them in the newspapers all the time. We see it as our role to define these terms so students have correct information. Again, there's a link right back to the part of the department that works on refugees. Perhaps a student didn't even realize that the department works with refugees. And I see that we've zoomed into the Syria part of the map. If you see lots of those blue flags, if you click into one, you get a sense of where that refugee camp is, but also the amount of people that are there. And if you go to the blue, the bubble, you can get a sense of our initiatives in that part of the world and what we're doing to assist the refugees in that part of the world. You can also scroll to the world that's in the top right and get a sort of a broad view, if you will, a wide lens to see where other refugee camps are around the world. And if we can just click into one around a bubble, and you can sort of see where the location is. This information changes all the time. We pull this data in live from the UNHCR. And it's simple but powerful. It's simple because where you see the settlement or the refugee camp is and the amount of people there, that helps students, I think, understand a bit more about what a refugee situation is. So this is a great launching ground for understanding more about refugee situations around the world. Kate, before we move to questions, is there anything you want to add in or say?
I think just to reiterate that this has been such a resource. Many of our teachers come into our program not with a full grasp of what an embassy is, what a diplomat is, what these different global issues are. They may not be an expert in their assigned country or embassy. And so for our office, this has really been a tool to say, here's a place you can go where it's easily laid out, easily explained, and then it's a way that our teachers as well as our students can continue to learn about diplomacy, which is a great thing for us.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much. I'm going to look up here to see if I have any questions. We're monitoring our Twitter and our Facebook feeds at the moment. I know we've worked with a lot of educators looking at the content. It's also been wonderful to work with our diplomats here at the State Department gathering this information and the stories. Another important resource to mention to our teachers and educators is that we have a wonderful blog called DipNote. And these are really short, wonderful entries written by our diplomats who are on the ground. And it's another opportunity to provide that very quick overview of the kind of work our diplomats do and where, the kind of challenges that they encounter, and the kind of fun that they have as well. I'm going to add that in too. Okay, so here's a question. Have you worked with teachers or students directly to help to develop the resource? We have. We pilot tested this with lots of local teachers. Have you developed strategies to address difficult subjects such as human trafficking with students? That's a really important question. Indeed, some of these issues that we were talking about, like human trafficking, we didn't necessarily talk about that today, but that is a very important issue. And we see our role first and foremost with educators and students is to define what this issue is and what our diplomats are doing towards that issue. We've also developed here a diplomatic simulation program which allows students to research a role on any given international topic. We have one that looks at genocide issues and Darfur in 2009. So it really allows students to kind of get into what that issue is and to play roles, different roles of diplomats from different perspectives, for them to understand the complexity of some of these issues and the difficulty at arriving at a solution together as a group, not just as one country, but working with many to try and solve an international issue. So we feel our diplomatic simulation program is one way that we can really help students to understand the complexity of some of what these issues are. Another question, how do you plan to address challenging historical moments in accurate and honest ways with teachers? You know, that's a good question too. As our students and teachers meet our diplomats, and I know especially through once our museum opens and they have an opportunity to meet diplomats on the floor when they come for tours and briefings, one thing that diplomats will always say is that being a diplomat is challenging. This is tough work, and it's not to sugarcoat it. Solving important issues like human trafficking or addressing the needs of refugees, these are very difficult issues that require a lot of tact and skill diplomatically. So we don't want to sugarcoat anything for our students. I think our diplomatic simulation program also offers an opportunity for students to learn firsthand how working together, even though you have opposing views, is something that is challenging, but it takes great diplomatic skill of listening and persuasion and good communication skills to find a solution that works for everyone. And one last question. How did you decide on what the resources will focus on? That's a good question. And some of it is just very basic, and that is what information that was available to us to be able to put online. Finding stories that really capture the work of the department is challenging, but we feel like we've gotten the best of what our diplomats are doing, and that's what we've chosen to focus, to make it easier for students and teachers to understand. And there's more coming. Yes, we are constantly updating, and we'll be constantly adding these stories onto the issues website. So as students and teachers visit it day or weeks to come, they'll see changing and new information on there, as well as the information that's posted on our blog. Those really are stories that kind of capture the work of our diplomats, and that's really what we want to do. That's our goal, is to share the good work of what we're doing. I think that's it. Kate, thank you so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate that.
Okay, and thanks to all of you for joining us, and we hope to see you soon on the U.S. Department of State Google Plus Hangout. Thanks.